Alright, so when it's a build chip with a fudge the ultimate form, there's no way that Kevin would stand a chance to even.
No. This again.
What did you call this?
Cooking with Jasper.
Oh yeah, cooking with Jasper, or cooking for Megan, or something like that. Okay, what we're going to do today is something different than the past two times that we've done this. We're actually going to cook something decent this time. What we're going to cook is lime. We're going to cook poisson pour deux, which is like appropriately titled poisson, as in almost the same as poison, but with one letter difference, and so it just means fish. Okay, so we're going to cook fish in a Asian Singaporean manner, which is this fish right here. And it's supposed to be very easy, within 30 minutes it should be done. And it should taste great, like good airline food, I'm told. Okay, so, first of all, we're going to take the fish, and apparently we're going to pat it dry with a kitchen towel. It must be a more of an Asian thing. I've never really done that without being asked, so maybe we should just skip that part. Can't emphasize how important it is to dry the fish. Okay, we can't skip that part, let me grab the towel. So drying it off with a kitchen towel. This is technically a kitchen towel. We also have paper ones, but I'm going to assume it's this. Set of transcription regulators. Cultured cell bound to the fibroblasts have been reprogrammed to become induced pluripotent stem cells. Okay, now that the fish has been properly patted dry, we're going to move on to the next step, which is about these green beans right here. It says that they actually have to be frozen and then defrozen, but I thought it was just more logical to buy them already not in their frozen form. Like a good cook, you should always use the freshest of ingredients and then also still wash them with water, so that all the people who eat your dish won't suffer from diarrhea afterwards. So make sure you really wet all of those green beans. Not a single one needs to be left dry. Alright, now that the beans have been properly cleaned, in a more sensical manner than the fish, I must say. We're going to move on to the furnace over here. Now the beans we're going to put.
Zou je eerst niet even snijden, Jasper?
So I've just been informed that apparently it may be a good idea to also cut the ends of the beans before trying to eat them, which is news to me, but you know, I'm happy to oblige to the critical viewer who is of the opinion that that might be a good idea. So let's do that first. It's going to take a while.
Jasper, doe het me niet aan, alsjeblieft. Permissie tot overname.
And there we go, masterfully done, if I do say so myself. Now we'll move on to the next step, which is actually, I should mention beforehand that we're going to do this as a two-part series. We're going to cook the fish, but not only are we going to cook the fish, we're also going to do a blind taste test afterwards, and we see if we can actually taste any salt, pepper, or paprika on there, because I'm of the firm belief that these four ingredients are fictional. So, when we do taste them, and I have no idea what is on which part of the fish, then we'll know for certain that you'll never have to use any of these ingredients ever again in your life. So, we're going to divide the fish, each fish, into three equal parts, without damaging the filaments of which the fish is made to preserve the maximum amount of flavor. So really nice, smooth. Okay, now we need to rub all sides of the fish with salt, pepper, and paprika. Now, both me and my handy-dandy cameraman have no idea how much is a lot. Okay, so this is, I'd say, quite a decent amount of salt. because we're also going to put all of these powders on there during the cooking process. Of course, the preparation is half the battle, as they say in the cooking world. So yeah, this one will only have salt. Oh, looks like the fibers of this fish are very tough, so part of them was still attached to it. And like you want to massage that right into the fish. Right, now the next one, the first one we've left blank, like you're supposed to, according to some more yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So this one will have salt and pepper. Look how huge these are. That's this. Okay, sure. Okay, and you see those little black spots that are supposed that people tell you up. Oh, that people tell you that that tastes like something. Now they are on here as well. And just for formality's sake, I'll massage them as well.
Waarom doe je zo weinig hiervan?
I feel like.
Kom, je kan het. Peter, kom. Gewoon, je kan helemaal doordraaien.
I know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Okay, so this looks like a more or less adequate amount on one side, but of course we're going to double that up. This should not try to not fall apart, please. Yeah, okay. I'm going to double it up here as well. I think that's plenty. And then we will massage it once again. I hope the camera picked it up. Okay, and this one, I'm going to only put some paprika on there. This is paprika pikant, which is Dutch for paprika. Oh. Again, like Bob Ross says in painting, in cooking there are no mistakes. All right, so something like that.
So angry.
Okay, fine. I can actually feel it burn from here in my mouth, but okay, so maybe paprika you do taste, but it's not going to be great, it's not going to be good. This one is going to be the best. I almost touched it, but I didn't. If you think it's accidentally a lot, it's intentional. Alright, and now we're going to put the past three ingredients all on this one. So, of course, plenty of salt. I've been told recently that this much salt is apparently a lot of salt. Well, the same amount of pepper or paprika is considered not much of those. So even someone as advanced in cooking as myself still learns a few things now and then. Yeah, look at that. I mean, I'll give them that it looks nice, it's nice and colorful, and it does look more appetizing, but it's all a placebo effect. There's no difference in taste, actually, which you'll find out soon enough. When you feel like there's a burning sensation on your hand and you're worried that you've got a cut on your finger and have gotten salmonella this way, just remember that things are an occupational hazard, and cooking, like many things, is an art form that one can only really attain true pride in and get really great accomplishments with when one suffers through it. So, and besides that, a bit of blood on there will give the fish more of a taste than any of these ingredients will. And then the final one will have both pepper and paprika on it. Alright, so now, about 20 minutes later, the fish has been properly spiced. And I just want to point out that the main part of the duration of cooking this dish is once again putting all these pointless ingredients on there. It's not only a waste of space, a waste of money, but it's also a waste of your time, which you could be spent better trying to cut these, because these take a long time to cut. I don't understand how people can really do it at all this way. Alright, now we've done all the preparation necessary, and we can go to actually cooking the dish. To do that, you're going to want to use some olive oil, and the more you use, the more calories it will have. Now, in this big one, which the culinary people think has a name, but actually it's just called the big one, we're going to put all of these green beans, which have been masterfully cut, as I said before. Oh. Exactly. And an essential part of the cooking process is to also turn the furnace on.
Okay. Then we're going to put all of these fish pieces in this small pan, which is deliberate. But the reason will stay secret.
This way we can be sure that all of the fish will be cooked thoroughly.
Alright, and then we kind of wait and pay attention a bit and do some Scrabble in the meantime. As you can see, things are progressing quite nicely. Everything's perfectly fine and under control. You might be worried about the spices mixing when things are so close together, but it's actually a myth. No. Ow! look at that. Okay, when in doubt, you can use two of these. Of these grabbers. Which is also a term they teach you in cooking school. And when the fish is about done, you can see that it's nice and white on the opposite side. So you can see it's a bit less here because of the spices, but which is also another reason I should just not use spices at all. And now here we're going to add also some salt, pepper and garlic powder to the mix, because that's what the recipe says, and we're going to prove the recipe wrong shortly. Alright, yeah, that seems like an adequate amount. So, also some pepper, and then we're not going to add the paprika to it apparently, but these... I'm not entirely sure whether it's working, it's probably not working. Sometimes there are manufacturing problems with the spices that are being made, and we don't...
Just fixing the manufacturing problems.
Yeah. But nothing that even a simple cameraman who can do no cooking at all really can just fix. And when you turn it, as you would intuitively expect, the garlic comes out. And this also seems like an adequate amount.
So now you have to turn them once again to see whether they are almost done, which they appear to be, because the color has somewhat changed. And when cooking and food changes color, it is usually a good sign. It's also one of the first things that are taught in cooking school.
So once again, they may fall apart a bit. That's only to emphasize the juiciness of the fish at its core, which we've brought out with our excellent cooking.
Dit ga ik echt nooit meer kunnen onderscheiden. Ik ga mijn best doen.
Oh, and it's already done! Look at that! Okay, it took a second. Now, this is the actual end result, and does that not look tasty? And here we have the taste test, which we'll be performing. Of the six different fish parts with all different spices on there. And to do that, follow me to the living room.
Ik ben het op een vork aan het krijgen, wat echt onmogelijk is.
Good mythical evening. As you can see, I can't. That's because we're going to do a blind taste test now of the six different fish pieces with all different spices on them and see if it is even distinguishable what piece has what spice.
I never realized that a heart but a link must have it if we can't see the length of the Oh no, they get never mind. I know I didn't do it. This is not the end of the fork, is it?
Yeah, nice. Mm.
It's good. It's probably a 7 out of 10, even though it's cold already. And I'd say that this has no spice at all on it. Or maybe it has pepper, but I'm going to say no spice at all. Yeah,
it's going to fall off.
This is actually a lot better than the last one.
And I'd say it's pepper and salt. Yeah.
Alright, so now that I've grasped my fork in a manner of human would, I'm going to taste the third fish now.
I find it very difficult. I would say no spice at all as well. So maybe the first one was wrong then. I'm going to hedge my bets and say that this one has no spice. Okay, so that's what I think. What it tastes like. Yeah.
This is the fourth fish.
Was there also one with pepper and paprika?
Mm-hmm.
This one is pepper and paprika, I'd say. Yeah. Fairly confident.
Is this the fifth one?
Yeah. Het wordt echt steeds beter.
I'd have to say no spice at all. I don't taste it. No, I'm sorry. It's my honest opinion. And this is the last one. Once again, no spice at all. No spice. No dice.
So, I was about to give a closing statement, but after having been threatened by my cameraman, I'm going to change it a bit. So apparently, I've been told that salt tastes pretty good after all. I hate myself for saying that. So you should apparently use salt on dishes in the future. And if you're going to use pepper or paprika, you should use liberal amounts of it or not use it at all. And that's the only conclusion we can draw from this. So to all the times that I have not used salt in the past, I will say I was wrong.